Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have apologies from Natalie Dawn and Evelyn Tweed, and as my Evelyn Tweed is here, I'm glad to say as her substitute. I am reminded by my laptop going off that we should have our mobile phones on silent, please. Our first item of business this morning is a decision to take item 6, consideration of our work programme in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. Agenda item 2 is an evidence session on the Social Security Advocacy Service Standards Scotland Amendment Regulations. As is this is the committee's first consideration of affirmative regulations, I'll quickly summarise the process. We'll start with an evidence session from the Minister, and this will be followed by a formal debate on the motion. The Minister will be given the opportunity to move the motion and respond at the end. The committee will be asked to make a recommendation to Parliament on whether we consider these regulations should be approved. This recommendation will be made via a report. Before I begin, I'd like to thank the Minister for sharing the draft amended advocacy standards with the committee to allow us to make a more informed decision on the regulations being considered. I do remind colleagues that these draft regulations were shared in confidence and therefore would encourage members with any questions on these to refer to the draft standards in general terms, please. I'd like to welcome to the committee once again, become a bit of a habit, Minister, Ben McPherson, Minister for Social Security and Local Government, Dr Rory Sutherland, supporting access to Social Security team leader, Social Security Policy Division. Online, we are also joined by Colin Armstrong, Sponsorship and Delivery Manager, Social Security Policy Division, and James Cleland, Solicitor with the Scottish Government Legal Directorate. I'd like to invite the Minister now to make an opening statement on the regulations, please. Minister.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. I'm pleased to be here today to talk about our new Social Security Advocacy Service Standards. I'm also pleased to confirm, as I have done in writing to you, that following a regulated procurement process, we have now awarded the first 4-year contract for the provision of an independent advocacy service as required by the Social Security Scotland Act 2018, and I will provide a little more detail on this shortly. First, though, I will give a brief overview of the amendment sought by the Social Security Advocacy Service Standards Scotland Amendment Regulations 2021. The Social Security Advocacy Service Standards set out the standard of service that independent third-party organisations are required to provide on behalf of the Scottish Government. The current Advocacy Service Standards were published in January 2020, and they restrict providers to the use of individual instructed advocacy. This is where the individual is able to directly communicate to the advocacy worker what outcomes they want, as well as the actions they would like taken. Through extensive consultation with stakeholders on our advocacy short life working group, and these include the Scottish Independent Advocacy Alliance, Citizens Advice Scotland, and several independent advocacy providers, it became clear to us that removing the restriction to instructed advocacy in the service standards would increase the scope of the service and build on our human rights-based approach by making it more widely accessible. This amendment to the service standards was therefore suggested by stakeholders in the advocacy sector and is one which enjoys a unanimous support of the members of the Advocacy Short Life Working Group, and we are pleased to respond to that by bringing this amendment forward to you today. Crucially, this amendment allows providers to offer non-instructed advocacy. This is an holistic approach where the advocate combines alternative methods of communication with observations of the client and their situation and information from significant others in the client's life. This leads to a more person-centred approach where providers are able to offer the forms of advocacy which are most appropriate to each client according to their circumstances. This will increase the scope of the service, reduce any potential for confusion, and avoid potentially inconsistent outcomes. And I'm sure the committee will agree that this is a positive step towards providing a more inclusive service and helping disabled people access social security. These service standards are designed to be applied in practice, and as I wrote to the committee yesterday to provide an update on, I provide an update on the delivery of the Independent Advocacy Service and the organisation which will be responsible for implementation of the standards. As I have mentioned, we have now concluded the regulated procurement process to appoint a national supplier, and I'm delighted to say that we will be working with Voiceability to fulfil this vital role. Voiceability is a charity with 40 years of experience of delivering independent advocacy services. They bring with them a deep knowledge of the sector and a wealth of experience in supporting those with disabilities to get the outcomes they deserve. Voiceability's delivery model promises a number of positive impacts for the people of Scotland, including commitments to establish a new base and bespoke training centre in Glasgow, to creating up to 100 new jobs and 3 apprenticeships as devolved benefits continue to be introduced, having a clear presence in all health boards at launch, recruiting 75% of their workforce from those who are long-term unemployed or who are economically inactive, signing the Scottish Business Pledge and paying at least the real living wage. This is an important step in the delivery of Social Security of the Social Security Scotland Act 2018 and a substantial contract award, with the Scottish Government committing to investing £20 million in the service over the next 4 years. So I'd be happy to provide any further information on all of this, which would be of value to members, and I move the motion. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. As one colleague has already indicated, happy to take questions now. So I'll start with Jeremy Balfour and move to further colleagues after Mr. Balfour.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister and colleagues. First of all, can I say how welcome I think this amendment is? I think it will open up lots of avenues for everybody who's offering advice to the most vulnerable, and so totally supportive of it. I wonder if I can just ask a few questions around the advocacy service and how you see that developing. If I give you 3 questions, Minister, I hopefully have to come back. The first one is in regard to funding. Is this new funding that will be paid to it? So obviously there are other organisations already providing advocacy services which get Scottish Government money. So is this new money, or will this be money that will be taken from advocacy services which you're already providing? Secondly, how will parents and going forward others know about this service? How do you see it being advertised so that people can make use of this service? And finally, how do you see this fitting into already what is happening within tribunals for advocacy services? So we've got CEB, advice shops, other organisations already doing that. Is this an exclusive thing that people are going to, or will people still be able to choose to go to another organisation and get funding for that? Thank you.
Okay. Come back on those, Convener. Thank you. It is new funding. This is an investment of £20 million, as I said, in a new service in order to fulfil the obligations in the 2018 Act. So that will be the investment that we will be making over 4 years. With regard to raising awareness, we will be working with Voiceability, and I'll be pleased to keep the committee updated on our engagement with them as they develop their presence here in Scotland and create the networks in order to deliver the service effectively, and that will be part of working with a range of different partners, which is what they have done in other parts of the UK, in order to raise awareness of the service. And of course, we have an obligation on ourselves as part of the 2018 Act, and we are very focused as ministers and the agency is too, and the wider government, on raising awareness of what support is available to people in terms of social security in the round. In terms of the point about it being exclusive, the support within the support that people will need with regard to devolved benefits delivered by Social Security Scotland, where advocacy is necessary or is requested, and that will be delivered exclusively by Voiceability. But of course, people will still, if they want to get advice, be able to go to the Citizens Advice Bureau or through other organisations. And that, of course, the distinction between advocacy and advice is an important one, which Mr Balfour will recall that we discussed at length during the process of the 2018 Act. I don't know, Rudy, if you want to come in on any of those three points with any further.
To just seek clarification on that point. So if I go to a tribunal for my PIP hearing in due course, which is going to be run by Social Security Scotland, and I'm looking for an advocate to represent me at that tribunal, at the moment I have the choice of choosing to go myself and advocate myself, or I can go and have CAB or the Advice Shop in Edinburgh or other organisations across Scotland do that. Are we saying now that the only people that will be allowed to advocate at a tribunal will be this grouping that you're paying for? So are we closing the door for other organisations to be able to do advice at tribunal service? So is it an exclusive contract?
In terms of what Scottish Government will fund, yes. But Rui, do you want to talk about if people wanted to undertake a preference?
Sure.
You don't need to press it.
Thank you. I think the point that the Minister makes about exclusivity in terms of the Scottish Government funded services is absolutely correct, but clients will be able to choose whichever service they want in terms of the support that they receive. But absolutely, as the Minister says, the funding now will be exclusively for voiceability advocacy services.
Means then going forward, funding for CAB and for other organisations will be cut. So if they bid for at the moment, so the Advice Shop in Edinburgh gets money from Edinburgh Council and from Scottish Government to offer advice and assistance, so they go along to tribunals, will that funding in due course then be reduced to these organisations because they're no longer able to give the advocacy service?
We can't speak on behalf of what City of Edinburgh Council will make in terms of choices in
the local
authority.
Government funding.
But of course, the advocacy services currently and advice services, and of course there is that distinction between advocacy and advice, provide advocacy and advice on a range of different social security benefits, many of which are reserved. So there's if people are looking for support with regard to reserved or other benefits, then of course services will still be available to them if funding choices are made in that regard. I mean, I have to also emphasise that, you know, we went through a regulated procurement process for this, and bidders were encouraged, as you would. You would appreciate and would be appropriate. So we've gone through this process and this is the outcome. And, you know, there is a need to avoid double funding, of course. And that is a question in terms of the prudence of the public finances that the government has to always consider.
Thank you, Minister. Just before I bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy, just to be absolutely clear, you're still expecting Citizens Advice, for instance, or CABIA in my constituency to still be able to represent constituents at tribunals that would be held potentially in Social Security Scotland. It's just that they wouldn't be funded by the Scottish Government.
That is correct,
yeah.
Convener.
Thank you. Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister, and your officials. I have a question about the procurement process, first of all, but also in relation to the points made about funding. So you said that it's gone through a significant procurement process, which is excellent and what we would expect, of course. Some of those organisations that I might have expected to maybe end up providing that might have been one that, you know, already, for example, had a jurisdiction and worked already in Scotland. Were there any applications within that process from organisations that did deliver advocacy in Scotland already? I'd be keen to know a little bit about that, in particular, given what you've said about funding and that funding will be solely provided for the purposes of advocacy for Social Security Scotland to only one organisation, and that one organisation is based not here yet. So I'd be keen to know about that. The point I think that the convener made about people's representation at tribunals and also within their assessments, I think that's really important, because it's important that people have an option to be able to take the person that they have a relationship with as an advocate and to have a bit of choice in that. Notwithstanding the fact that if you're only funding one agency to do this specifically, then it does limit the choice. What will someone be able to still go to their assessment with someone else as their advocate, and that person's, that advocate's views would be not disregarded because they weren't working for Voiceability, for example?
So on the last question, Pam Duncan-Glancy, yes.
Okay.
And I'm going to bring Colin in a minute with regard to the procurement process, but just to say that this procurement process was undertaken twice. So it was undertaken from 2019 to 2020, and then an award wasn't made because of the pandemic, and the process was undertaken again. And throughout that whole process, there was engagement from Scottish Government officials with current providers to give them all the awareness and information in order if they wanted to, say, for example, make a collective bid. But that wasn't undertaken, and I'll let Colin say any more that he can or wants to on that.
This is the second procurement process. In terms of the other organisations that bid, we can't announce that here, I'm afraid. But there was three organisations bid. And it was a regulated procurement process, and you know it was done under the most, you know, some other one.
Thanks, Colin.
Two were within Scotland.
Sorry, thanks, Colin. I'll just say a bit more. I mean, our consortium bids were welcome, but not made. Two organisations with a presence in Scotland's. Citizens Advice Scotland and Money Matters made applications, but through the regulated procurement process, Voiceability were on the assessment that is made through the appropriate law and criteria were assessed as the strongest bid and therefore awarded the contract as appropriate.
Can I also just say that I think I would echo what we've already heard. The regulations are very welcome. I think it will open up opportunities for advocacy for other people. My final point and question on it was around the training for the advocacy provider. And have you given some thought to the sorts of training that they might get, what sort of training they'll have in terms of disabled people or carers, and will that take into account the range of conditions that they might be supporting people with, given that in the past, previous, not here, but in other jurisdictions, I guess, some of the assessors have not necessarily had the assessment, the training or support that might have been needed in order to be able to give the full support to the client that they need to.
I think that's a very important point, that set of points that Pam Duncan-Glancy makes, and one that we took very seriously through the consideration of the process. I'll bring Ruairi in a minute, who's had a lot of engagement with Voiceability on the lead up and since the award of the contract, to speak more to that. But these are important considerations that Voiceability have had up to this point in their service delivery elsewhere in the UK, and are important considerations for them as they build the service here in Scotland. And Ruairi, I don't know if you can say any more on that.
Yes, I think it's clear from meetings that we've had already with Voiceability that they're absolutely committed to working with the Scottish Government in developing their programme of training, as well as Social Security Scotland, who have a kind of existing training programme around working with disabled people, working with kind of various parts of the population, I guess. Voiceability have committed to setting up a bespoke training centre based in Glasgow. And that will deliver the training to all of their advocates, and we've already had discussions with Voiceability about using some resource from Social Security Scotland to support the delivery of that training. It's also important, I think, just to add to the Minister's point about Voiceability's previous experience in the rest of the UK, that they already support up to 30,000 people a year, and 80% of the clients that they supported last year had a disability of some description.
Thank you very much indeed. That's been very helpful. Just for the benefit, is anybody else looking to come in? Marie and Miles as well. I've got one quick question myself, and that is just for the benefit of potential service users, those that are watching today, could the Minister please outline how we can guarantee that Voiceability will be independent, and also their willingness and ability to be able to criticise Social Security Scotland and the Scottish Government if necessary?
So that's absolutely the focus of what we're amending in the regulations today. It's the standards that are set out, the advocacy service standards, which of course we're amending if the committee passes the instrument today, in order to those standards, and this has been the case throughout the interim service as well. Make sure that there's the quality of what is considered is, of course, appropriate and regulated, but also that independence is absolutely assured. And we went through this process in 2018 in order to make sure that when we went through the Act in 2018, there was a determination and a commitment to make sure that there was independent advocacy available. And this is us delivering that. So, you know, it will not be provided directly by anyone working for Scottish ministers, including staff of Social Security Scotland. It will be provided by people working for other organisations, so for Voiceability, and the advocacy worker will support Social Security advocacy rights and needs. They will work for the individual involved and on their behalf, free from conflicts of interests as possible. So that's all set out in the services, and of course Voiceability, and this is an important distinction, why it was an important, it's an important point of emphasis in terms of the award, because Voiceability will only be delivering advocacy. They will not be delivering advice. So they're specifically contracted to deliver the advocacy commitments within the 2018 Act and to be there for clients when they need them.
Thank you, Minister. Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener. Can we just go back to the point that Mr. Balfour made? I think Mr. Balfour's confusing advocacy services with advice and professional services. Surely an advocate is not expected to make welfare rights points during a tribunal. I think we need to be careful with the different roles there. I certainly welcome the regulations. As the Minister will know, the assistance people need often covers many entitlements in the range of Social Security benefits. Is it the case that some will need advocacy in regards to devolved and reserve benefits at the same time? And do you envisage this overlap getting in the way of overall advocacy a person needs?
So I think that the point is well made about advocacy and advice being different. Of course, advocacy, a provision of support, which helps someone express their rights, views and wishes and what they want to achieve, whereas advice would be imparting guidance or recommendation on someone with regard to a future action or decision. And the focus of Voiceability service will be on advocacy when it comes to Social Security benefits delivered by Social Security Scotland.
Okay. Miles Briggs, please. And then I've got Jeremy Balfour with a brief supplementary.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, to the panel. There's a couple of questions I wanted to ask. Firstly, to put on record, I think all of us around this table welcome a move to independent advocacy. But I think there are concerns around the organisation not having this footprint in Scotland and institutional knowledge. And I just wanted to ask a few questions around what assurances beyond the letter you provided the committee, you've had that this will genuinely be a national service. Setting up a centre in Glasgow is one thing, but Glasgow isn't Scotland, an apology to Glasgow members around this table, but I think that's important. We really make sure that this is a national service, and some of the barriers which we've heard previously are not going to be put up by a new service being established. And I just wonder if you could also outline to the committee what level of funding is currently provided to other organisations in Scotland to provide that advocacy.
So, I think Mr. Briggs raises important questions, and these were questions that we obviously considered as part of the award process. The VoiceAbility delivery model is built around home-based staff and an existing network of over 100 accessible co-location venues in local communities across the country. And that is what they have been engaged in and what they will be engaged in now going forward in terms of delivery of the contract. And this is an approach which the organisation has used since before COVID-19. So it's moved to digital and being in communities and utilising being accessible in that way is something that it was ahead of the game on before COVID-19. So that has allowed them to be flexible and responsive to fluctuating demand and also allows them to have a clear presence in all health boards at launch. So they will have a presence in all health boards, so that geographical presence that Mr. Briggs rightly raised will be there. And they are very committed, as you would expect, to creating this presence in Scotland and working with others in a collaborative manner. I look forward to seeing that happen, and I'm sure the committee will look forward to engaging with them too. As they expand into Scotland from a strong position of delivering in the rest of the UK, with that Scottish base in Glasgow, that bespoke training centre, and that will allow the organisation to ensure that advocates and volunteers are equipped with the knowledge and the skills, as we've already spoken about, to deliver this service to a high standard, as set out in the standards that we're discussing today. And they'll also scale up in line with demand, and that's an important thing. This is, we don't know necessarily what the demand will be, and we'll only see that when the service is rolled out. I think it's also important to emphasise, and I know I made this, as far as I can recall, this point was made in my letter, but there will be a working group that the service will engage with that will include key stakeholders having an input in terms of their engagement and VoiceAbility, but also crucially people with lived experiences. So in order that we make sure that we have that connection as well between the new service and those using it. So we're excited about what they're going to do and the performance of the contract, and we look forward to working with them as they roll it out. But of course then advocacy will be independent, as I've emphasised already in committee today. In terms of the costs, I would like to come back to the committee on that, because I don't have that figure with me just now, but I'll give an undertaking to come back on that point.
Yes, thank you, Convener. In terms of commitments as well, you've touched upon digital barriers. I think that's something which, to some extent, we have seen improvements, but from those sometimes further removed, we haven't. And I think that's something to maybe also consider what commitments around people who don't have access to digital technology. But also, in terms of BSL, language translation services, is there commitments which have been received on these issues as well to providing services and advocacy?
So I'll let Ruairi come in a minute in terms of engagement with VoiceAbility on that, but they are committed to providing an accessible service. That is what they've done before. And of course, as a government, we are committed to that accessibility generally when it comes to social security. That's why we've introduced our local delivery teams from Social Security Scotland to encourage people and help people to apply for benefits. And in a similar manner, those considerations have been, as you would expect, an important aspect of our considerations here. I don't know if you want to say anything more about that, Ruairi.
Yes, thank you. So VoiceAbility have already given a clear commitment to kind of fully accessible service, but it's also set out in the service standards which they will have to adhere to, that advocacy services and workers will communicate using the methods and forms that the client needs and prefers in all cases.
Thank you, Dr. Solander. Thank you, Mr. Briggs. Mr. Balfour, I think, had a brief supplementary.
Thank you.
And then I'll bring in Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you. Just to reassure Maylie, Marie McNair, as a person who drafted the amendments on advocacy, and I think I have a reasonable understanding of the difference between the two. Can I just go back to a point made by my colleague Miles Briggs? I live in Orkney, Shetland, and I'm looking for an advocate to come to the tribunal to me. I presume we have no presence, this company, yet in that areas. How will they provide that? So, or if I'm in Stornoway or in the more rural areas of Highland, how many people will be working in these areas? Because often there are maybe a tribunal in Inverness one on the same day as a tribunal in Stornoway. Will they be guaranteed that the advocacy that I need will be actually there on the day?
So I talked about the 100 co-location venues and that full accessibility and the presence in all health boards. So that combination of utilising those venues, being present in those health boards and the collaboration will mean that there will be support available to people no matter what their geographical location is in Scotland.
But I need to push you, Minister. There's a difference between being a presence in a health board and a presence and a tribunal on the day. Is there an absolute guarantee that if I need someone to advocate for me in Stornoway on a Tuesday morning, there will be enough people covering that to be able to provide that service?
The service commits to giving people the advocacy support they need, where they need it and when they need it. That is in the contract.
Thank you, Minister. Evelyn Tweed, I think, is the final question. Oh, sorry, Miles Briggs wants another supplementary. Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. Independent advocacy is to be absolutely welcomed. And Minister, I'm interested in the outcomes of the service and what it's actually going to achieve for people. How are you going to report these?
In terms of to Parliament or...
Yes.
Yeah. Well, we will continually review the service as part of the contract. There won't be a formal process in terms of parliamentary updates, but of course I will keep the committee updated and the committee will be able to inquire with Voiceability itself in terms of its performance on behalf of Parliament. But I can assure you that as we do with any procured contract for service, we will make sure that the contract is continually reviewed, that the performance is being considered, and that the service provider, in this case Voiceability, are fulfilling the needs of what we are contracting them for, but also of course the standards as well. Rudy, I don't know if you want to say any more about that. There are significant reporting aspects as part of the contract.
Sure. So, I mean, just as the Minister says, the contract sets out a number of significant reporting requirements on Voiceability. In terms of how that's reported to Parliament, that's something I guess that the Minister can consider and write to you on in the coming days. But there are significant reporting requirements, and those will feed into any contract extension. So the initial contract period is for 2 years, with an optional 2 12-month periods of extension beyond that, taking us to the full 4 years. And all reporting through that first 2 years will feed into any decisions around extension of the contract.
So those milestones within the contract are about assessing performance and provision. In terms of outcomes, we collectively, both the government and Parliament, will be watching to make sure that of course that the standards are met and that the service is being effective for people, and do that in due course.
Okay. Finally, Miles Briggs.
Thank you. It was just a question I had listening to conversation this morning around the health board model, and I wondered what rationale had been around using that. Now, I fully understand patient advocacy, but would it not make more sense for local government to be that kind of model, given that a lot of advocacy is already taking place within local government for people?
The considerations are—it's an illustration of the fact the fact that they will be present in all health boards is an illustration of the fact that they will be engaged across the country comprehensively, geographically, and of course, both in there are wider considerations around this in terms of the collaboration with different organisations and wider engagement in terms of awareness. The point that Jeremy Balfour rightly raised. There will be considerations around local governments, local government being informed and included in this process of raising awareness in particular, and we will of course engage with them on that. But in terms of why the considerations around the contract and why it's the health board presence that I've highlighted, it's just to illustrate that geographical. The geographical availability and the fact that there will be a comprehensive service throughout Scotland, and to make that point.
Thank you very much. If there are no further questions, we move on to the formal debate on the motion considered under the previous item, so our third item is to consider the motion S600996 that the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the Social Security Advocacy Service Standards Scotland Amendment Regulations 2021 be approved. I remind the committee that only members and the minister may take part in the formal debate. I invite the Minister to formally move the motion.
I hope that today's been helpful and that it's clear to the committee that this new service, along with the regulations under consideration, another step towards delivering a social security system that works for people with fairness and dignity and respect at its heart, and I move the motion, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister. Do any members wish to speak in the debate? Okay, good. I therefore put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S6M00996 in the name of Ben McPherson be approved. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much. The motion is therefore approved. I will now need to thank you very much, Minister, for your time this morning and your officials that have supported you as well. It's very much appreciated. I'll now briefly suspend to allow the Minister's officials to change over. Thank you. Thank you very much indeed, colleagues. Agenda item 4 is the committee's consideration of the Carers Allowance Supplement Scotland Bill at stage 2. The Minister for Social Security and Local Government stays with us for this item. Pleasure to have you again, Mr McPherson. I also welcome Maggie Chapman to the committee, who is here to speak to her amendments. The Minister is now joined by Andrew Strong, but I remind colleagues that as officials cannot take part in this debate, they're not named on the record, and Stephanie Vloglu is also watching from the public gallery as well. So, welcome. Everyone should have with them a copy of the bill as introduced, the marshal list of the amendments that were produced on Monday, and the groupings of amendments which sets out the amendments in the order in which they will be debated. There will be one debate on each group of amendments. I will call the member who lodged the first amendment in that group to speak to and move that amendment, and to speak to all the other amendments in the group. Members who have not lodged amendments in the group but who wish to speak should indicate by catching my attention in the usual way, and the debate on the group will be concluded by me inviting the member who moved the first amendment to wind up that group. Standing orders give any Scottish minister a right to speak to any amendment. I will therefore invite the minister to contribute to the debate just before I move to call the winding up speech. Following debate on each group, I will check whether the member who moved the first amendment in the group wishes to press it to a vote or to withdraw it. If they wish to press ahead, I will put the question on that amendment. If a member wishes to withdraw their amendment after it has been moved, they must seek the committee's agreement to do so. If any member objects, the committee immediately moves to the vote on the amendment. If any member does not want to move their amendment when called, they should say, "not moved." Please note that any other MSP may move such an amendment. If no one moves the amendment, I will immediately call the next amendment on the marshalled list. Only committee members are allowed to vote. Voting in any division is by a show of hands, and it is important that members keep their hands raised clearly until the clerk has recorded the vote. The convener has a personal vote as a committee member and also a casting vote in the event of a tie, and it is entirely a matter for the discretion of me as the convener how to use that casting vote. There are no agreed conventions on that point. However, if the casting vote is used, I would normally intend to indicate the basis on which I will use that casting vote before doing so. The committee is required to indicate formally that it's considered and agreed each section and schedule of the bill, and so I will put a question on each section at the appropriate point. If everybody is content with where we are after that brain dump, we now move on. I'm just conscious of making sure we get through that while this is the first time that we've considered stage two. We now move on to consideration of amendments. I would like to call Amendment 3 in the name of Maggie Chapman in a group on its own. Maggie Chapman to move Amendment 3.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thank you for the time, and thank you for going through that as well. It's my first time at stage two in committee. Carers fulfil an essential role across Scotland, and the pandemic has placed them under unprecedented strain. That's why I warmly welcomed this bill last week. It will help over 90,000 carers this winter through doubling the payment. As there is no green on this committee, I wanted to place the support on record here, and I'm grateful to the convener for giving me the chance to do that. But as I said last week, this is only part of what we need to do to ensure our social security system recognises and values the work carers do. As with universal credit and other benefits, we have our work cut out for us, and I welcome the willingness of the Scottish Government and others to work together to do better. Over the last couple of weeks, I have had useful meetings with the Scottish Government and support, about support for carers, including young carers, and the meeting this week with the Social Security Minister was particularly helpful. These conversations have been wide-ranging, and I thank the Minister for his time and the information and assurances he has given, and the ongoing discussions I know we will have. On that basis, I'm content that there are other avenues to explore and by which we can see action on the issues my probing amendments were seeking to address. So I will not move or press any of the amendments lodged in my name today. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Chapman. Any other members wish to speak at this stage? Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener, and forgive me if this is the incorrect moment to say this, but I actually think this is a really, really good amendment, and we have a really strong opportunity here to send a signal that carers who have worked day and night for the throughout the pandemic and before that, because we mustn't forget that unpaid carers have been providing unpaid care long before the pandemic, but they've been doing it in this year in particular under a lot of stress, a lot of strain, and many have been plunged into poverty. I will.
Jeremy Balfour.
I'm obliged. I understand where the member's coming from, and I think you see as a debate we had last couple of days ago, and no doubt will continue. But I'm slightly concerned that one group will get £711.46, while other carers will get nothing with these changes. Is there not a better way than picking on one set of carers, but to deal with all carers? And is this the right methodology to do it on this one?
I take the member's point, and actually I think you're right in terms of the number of people who are going to miss out. I think Carers Allowance and therefore Carers Supplement is only available to 1 in 10 people who are providing unpaid care across Scotland. So it's absolutely correct to say that this does not meet the needs of all the unpaid carers in Scotland, but none of this bill meets the needs of all the unpaid carers in Scotland. What we're doing by applying the uplift at this particular point is recognising that the people who are captured by the bill, the people who will get the supplement, get a supplement that is representative of the amount of money that we think and that we as a parliament this week agreed was enough money, or agreed was a better reflection of the amount of money people needed to live on. And we have an opportunity today to make sure that we apply that uplift for unpaid carers, which is why I think it's a really, really important mechanism to use it. The government and all parties around, or almost all parties around this table, at least the ones in opposition, agreed that uplift was essential, and I think we need to do all we can. So you asked whether I feel like this is the best mechanism. It's not the best mechanism because it's missing 9 in 10 carers. However, it's the only mechanism we have, and as the government has said, it's the fastest mechanism we have right now to put money in unpaid carers' pockets, which is why I strongly support this particular amendment, and if it's possible for me to do that, I would move this amendment.
Thank you. Would any other members wish to speak at this stage? Minister.
Thank you, Convener. Improving support for carers, of course, was one of our first priorities with our new social security powers. And our carers allowance supplement launched in September 2018 has increased carers allowance by 13%. Carers in Scotland continuously in receipt of carers allowance and carers allowance supplement will have received £2,270 more than carers in the rest of the UK since launch. We have secured the resource, and that's an important point, for a doubling of the December carers allowance supplement in this year's budget. We must therefore focus this bill that we're considering today on ensuring we get this increase to carers in December. Amendment 3 would increase by £480.06 the amount of carers allowance supplement to be paid this December. This would more than triple the amount. Certainly, yep.
Thank you, Minister. Do you think that the current amount of support that unpaid carers get from the state, either through the supplement or through Carers Allowance, is sufficient to keep them out of poverty?
I think, I thank Pam Duncan Glancy for that intervention, and I think there's more that we need to consider and do for carers as we look to bring in Scottish Carers Assistance. But we also have to work within the fixed budget of the Scottish Parliament, and I think it's important to consider that the fact that we are working within a budget that was set in the spring in order to deliver this is an important point of consideration.
Your point.
I will, yes.
Thank you, Convener, and I do really appreciate you taking a second intervention. And you're right to point out that it was based on a budget that was set in spring, but another committee this week, the Equality, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee, heard from organisations, including carers' organisations and women's organisations, that the distance between the programme for government and the budget process, the timescale between it, was in actual fact a bit restrictive in exactly the way you've just described, because you can set out your programme for government and all the aspirations you have, but you can continually, therefore, claim that you have to wait to make any material difference to people's lives by adding the budget in place. So can you consider a way that we could change that? And in addition to that, we also heard that whilst you have the the budget, whilst you have the budget within which you have to work, you have to be sure that you're using the maximum available amount of resources and targeting it at the most, the people who need it the most. And I would consider that those people are unpaid carers.
So Pam Duncan-Glancy is right in that as a government, we do want to target our support towards those who need it the most, which is why we have committed to and brought forward this bill in order to pay a double supplement in December to give that added support and secured that budget. I can't speak to the evidence heard in another committee because I haven't seen it myself, and I'm sure Pam Duncan-Glancy will appreciate that. So, you know, it's important to remember that Section 2 will allow us in this bill that we're considering today the flexibility to consider the need for increases for future periods. And, you know, I appreciate that may be a point with other amendments that we're considering in due course. And that must be done through budget processes alongside considerations of funding for wider support for carers. One way that this could, of course, be improved is would be any moves from the UK government to increase the underlying level of carers' allowance. And that, of course, would be something that we would welcome. But the challenge in considering resource available in this year's budget is the important point of consideration with regard to this amendment in particular. So I can't support this amendment, convener, because any further increase this year would require resource to be allocated from elsewhere in the budget, a budget that was agreed by Parliament, and that would have repercussions in other parts of government spending, and we can't do that recklessly. That needs to be considered. So on that basis, I'm grateful that following discussion on these points, Maggie Chapman was content not to move this amendment based on the arguments that she has put and I have also put forward. In terms of a position of responsibility and consideration of the budget in the round, this isn't something that we can do at this point, and I would urge members to reject this amendment on that basis and focus, as we should, on making sure that we get that double supplement that is provided for in the budget to carers in December who have entitlement to carers' allowance, and to make sure that they get that benefit in good time. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much, Minister. I apologise to Evelyn Tweed and to Miles Briggs. I had set out at the outset that I would call other members after the amendment had been moved, then the Minister, then I would call the leader amendment proposer to wind up. So I'd note, Ms Chapman, that you wished to withdraw the amendment. However, having spoken to it, the debate has started. So I'd invite you to press or withdraw Amendment 3, please.
I will withdraw.
Thank you. So the question is that Amendment 3... No, apologies, I'll suspend for 2 minutes. Are members content to have Amendment 3 withdrawn? Are we all agreed? No, there will be, in that case, there will be a vote. I would like to call all those in favour of withdrawing the amendment to please raise their hand. I'll call all those not in favour of withdrawing the amendment to please raise their hand. I suspend for 2 minutes. Thank you very much indeed, colleagues. Just to clear up confusion, that vote was for the Amendment 3 to be agreed to or not. The amendment was not agreed. There were six against, two for, so the amendment is not agreed. We move now on to consideration of Amendment 4. In the name of Maggie Chapman, which will be grouped with Amendments 5, 8 and 9. I invite Maggie Chapman to move or not move.
Thank you, Convener. Not moved.
Thank you very much indeed. Would any member like to speak to these amendments? Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Convener. And it's my intention to move 4, 5, 8 and 9 if the member decides not to move them herself. I mean, I think these are actually quite helpful amendments by Maggie Chapman, and I thank her for bringing them to the committee this morning. Amendment 4 asks Scottish ministers to review CAS amount paid once payment is made and report to a Parliament. And I think that's quite a helpful amendment because it will allow this committee and it will allow the whole Parliament to review what is going on an ongoing basis. It will also include a new increasing young carers grant in a similar manner. And again, I think that is something we perhaps all have aspirations to want to happen, even if it can't quite happen at the moment. So I think this is a helpful amendment as it keeps the issue alive for us as a committee and the Parliament, and it means we can go to forward on it. Amendment 8 is a kind of pavement amendment, so if Amendment 4 goes through, then Amendment 8 would be there for a pavement amendment. In regard to Amendment 5, it calls for a review on whether people caring for more than one person should get more money before they make this one-off type of payment again. And again, this is an issue that the committee grasped with in its last session, and I think we've already had evidence given to us as well around this, in that how do we deal with people who are caring for more than one person? And this will, I think, become a growing issue as we have elderly parents, you have one or two, or in a lot of cases, you maybe have two children in a family who have a disability and need caring for, and we haven't quite ever grasped that. So again, I think this is a helpful amendment which keeps this issue alive. And in regard to Amendment 9, again, I think this is a pavement amendment for Amendment 5, so falls in with that. So can I again thank Maggie Chapman for bringing this towards the committee and for helping us to, I think, have not only a wider review, but a continuing conversation as a Parliament around these issues.
Would any other member wish to speak? Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. And just to reiterate what my colleague Jeremy Balfour has said, I think these are very useful amendments, and again, would thank the member for bringing them forward. Further to what she's outlined to the committee at stage two about discussions she's had with the Scottish Government on this, can she reassure us that the Scottish Government and the Green Party will bring these back to Parliament at stage three, so that the work, which I think is important within these amendments, is actually going to be taken forward? And has she received that commitment from the Minister? And the Minister's here, so he can maybe also outline that to committee.
I don't know. I'm happy to defer to the Minister on that. We've had several discussions about the information that those amendments sought to address. Some of that information is available already. There are further reporting and information mechanisms that will be made publicly available as consultation and discussions carry on. But I don't know if the Minister wants to say anything else.
I'll come in when...
Before I call the Minister, I wonder if any other member would wish to speak to Amendment 4 and those in the group. No, in that case, I'll call the Minister, please. Marie McNair.
Ad hoc nature of these amendments is not a way to proceed, so therefore I can't support.
Thank you, Ms McNair. Call the Minister.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to colleagues. And I respect and appreciate the points that Jeremy Balfour makes. However, I do not believe that the review and reporting obligations that would be imposed by the amendments in this group are required, and this is why. The Scottish Government has recently published evaluations on both the Carers Allowance Supplement and the Young Carer Grant, as Maggie Chapman alluded to just moments ago. These show that the supplement has gone some way to meeting its overall aims. to improve outcomes for carers by providing extra financial support and to provide greater recognition of the essential societal contribution that carers make. And the majority of young carer grant recipients felt it helped to make a difference to their lives, gave them access to more opportunities and improved their mental well-being. So we are progressing our work to we've undertaken all of that, and we are progressing our work to deliver Scottish Carers assistance as well, including the commitment for an additional payment for those with multiple caring roles. And therefore, I cannot support these amendments because meeting these reporting requirements, these additional reporting requirements that would be created as a result of these amendments, would require reallocation of resources internally in the Scottish Government away from our work developing Scottish carers assistance and away from ongoing work to consider improvements to the Young Carer Grant.
Sorry, I was going to call you Cabinet Secretary. Would the Minister take an intervention on that point?
Yes.
So if you're not reporting to Parliament, internally, what reporting are you doing? If it's going to remove resources away, and you say, what reporting would then be taking place? And if you're doing it internally, why can my information not be shared with the Parliament?
Well, as I said, we have recently published evaluations on both the carers allowance and the young carer grant, and we'll continue to do that as appropriate in due course. But to place the obligation would, as I said, take resources away from developing Scottish Carers assistance and the ongoing work to consider improvements to the Young Carer Grant, which is where our focus, I think, should be. If these amendments were not agreed to today, just in direct response to Miles Briggs, there would be no intention to bring these back at stage three. However, I can commit to continue to explore options outside of the bill, and I've obviously talked about what we've done in terms of evaluation in recent times. Convener, I'm grateful for the discussions that I've had on these points with Maggie Chapman in recent days, and that she proposes to seek to withdraw Amendment 4. However, if another member, as Jeremy Balfour has stated he may, seeks to move the amendments, then, convener, as much as I'm grateful for the debate that we've had on these points, I would urge members to reject each of the amendments on the reporting requirements, as these will retract from our work on developing the new Scottish carers assistance. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much, Minister. Maggie Chapman had indicated she wished to withdraw Amendment 4. Since then, it has been moved by Jeremy Balfour. So I called Jeremy Balfour to sum up the debate and to press or withdraw Amendment 4.
Thank you, Convener. I am just slightly confused by the Minister's response here. We're told on one hand we're trying to evaluate, we're trying to do all the work, we're producing reports, and then we're told that we're taking away resources if we have this report to Parliament. It feels slightly to me that the government is trying not to be open to scrutiny from Parliament and is deciding its scrutiny on its own terms. And for that reason, I think both Amendment 4, 5, 8, 9 are important, and it is my intention to move Amendment 4.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Balfour. The question is that Amendment 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed, so there will be a vote. I would ask all those who are in favour of Amendment 4 to please raise your hand. All those against, please raise your hand. Thank you very much indeed, colleagues. That vote on Amendment 4, the result was a tie with 4 in favour, 4 opposed. In this regard, I will need to use my casting vote as chair, and given the assurances that have been given by the Minister that he will continue to evaluate and assess in other means, I am willing to cast my vote against. So the result of the vote will be 5 against, 4 for, and amendment falls. I'll now call Amendment 5 in the name of Maggie Chapman, already debated with Amendment 4. Maggie Chapman has indicated she wishes to withdraw. However, it's since been moved by Jeremy Balfour. Jeremy Balfour, do you wish to move or not move?
Move.
Sorry, have I suspend? Sorry. Mr. Balfour, do you wish to move or not move?
Move.
Okay. In which case, there will be a division. Are all members content with Amendment 5? That we are not agreed, so there will be a division. All those in favour of Amendment 5, please raise your hands. All those against? Thank you very much. The vote on Amendment 5 is as follows. Four, against four. Again, as there is a tie, I will need to use my casting vote. And again, based on the assurances given by the Minister regarding further work in this area, I am willing to cast my vote against. Therefore, the result is against 5-4-4, and the amendment falls. I will. The question now is that Section 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. I will now like to call Amendment 1 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, grouped with Amendment 6. Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Convener. And at the outset, I will be moving Amendment 1.
It's okay, Karen.
Amendment 1 in my name, and I will also be supporting, if moved, Amendment 6 by Pam Duncan Clancy. I think, for me, this is the key issue for us. Going forward in this bill. It is very welcome that this double payment is going to be paid this year, and I appreciate it's coming out of a budget that has already been set, and thus will have to be found. However, we have seen many delays to the Scottish benefits being delivered by Scottish ministers, and we need to get on and deliver them. And I'm hoping that the timescales that the government have given, that they will be met, even if they are not what we had hoped for when we first started on this journey. But there's no guarantee that's going to happen. We don't know, none of us have a silver ball, none of us know what's going to happen in the next few years, and there could be further delays. And so what this amendment seeks to do is to give an increase of a one-off payment every year to double it. Now, we haven't set the budget yet. Budget negotiations, I presume, are going on between ministers and between the Finance Cabinet Secretary. So this can be budgeted for and it can be put into next year's budget. And I appreciate it is more money, but I am presuming that the Scottish Government are going to pay all the benefits that they are already committed to. So we're told that it has to come under a budgetary negotiation. But that is true with all benefits, in that PIP, DLA, attendance allowance all have to be met. And as the Minister is well aware, it's a demand-led service. So none of us can be absolutely sure how much the Social Security budget is going to be. We have seen the Social Security budget go up this year because of what's happened in the last 18 months. That will be true perhaps in future years as we perhaps have benefit take-up, benefits will go up, and that will all have to be met within the Scottish Government budget. So I think this is a reasonable thing. I think it gives people some kind of guarantee that they are going to get money. And as the Minister pointed out very forcefully on Tuesday afternoon in the Chamber, these are political decisions. These are decisions that we have to make politically. And we have taken different views around the universal credit issue, but here is a decision that we as a Scottish Parliament can make. It's a political decision that we can decide whether we want to take or not. And I suppose it says to people, how much do we value carers, not just in perhaps nice words, but actually with a financial package. And that's why I would move Amendment 1. I suppose if the Government and the Parliament wanted to be even more generous, we would then support Amendment 6 in the name of Pam Duncan Clancy, in that that gives two payments. And I can recognise the need for that, and I think in the particular financial circumstances, that is worth arguing for. And so we are given, I suppose, an option here, whether we make one-off payment until at least 2025, or whether we make two payments. And I would be interested to know what the Minister's view is around that. But I think it is clear to me that these are political choices. We can often criticise other governments for doing different things, but we have the power here in Scotland to do this today, to give a guarantee. And I hope all members of this committee will make the right political choice to say a very clear message. We care about carers and we want to support you financially. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Balfour. And I call Pam Duncan-Glancy to speak to Amendment 6 and both amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I think I, at the start, say I move this amendment in my name. This too is my first time in committee doing so. Colleagues, there are 392,000 additional people who have become carers overnight because of the pandemic. And not all of those people will be able to access some of this funding. But there are a significant number of people who can. And for those people, we need to show them that their recognition, that we recognise the work that they've done in this year. In the last year, I've spoken to carers and they've told me that they're undervalued, feel invisible, exhausted and broken. So before I go any further on the reasons where I would like the committee to support my amendment and our amendment, I want to say thank you to all of the unpaid carers in Scotland for the work that they did, whether or not it has been recognised with the financial uplift. I also want to say thank you to paid carers, without whom I wouldn't be sitting here today. Unpaid carers have worked 24/7 for a year with no break. They are absolutely exhausted. Carers in Scotland, I think it's important to remember, were also poorer than average before the pandemic due to a combination of factors, including access to secure, adequately paid, flexible employment and the additional disability-related costs, such as higher energy and transport costs. In 2019 alone, the Family Fund noted that a third of families they supported saw an income reduction in their household. A third of carers are struggling to pay utility bills. 47% have been in debt and half are struggling to make ends meet, cutting back on food and heating as a result. I think all of us around this table can agree that that is unacceptable. Carers were then hit harder by the effects of lockdown. Family Fund found that 78% of them reported their overall financial situation had got worse. Half of families surveyed have seen their income fall as a result of the coronavirus pandemic through furlough and increased caring responsibilities. And at the Equalities and Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee the other day, we heard that in some cases, many women have had to give up paid work to undertake unpaid care. And that has cost in excess of £15 million a day. The uplift to carers' benefit that was applied by doubling the carers' supplement during the pandemic is absolutely the right thing to do. But the pandemic is nowhere near over, and all opposition parties and indeed the government agreed to that principle this week when they made the same argument about the need to retain the uplift in universal credit. The Scottish Government has promised to introduce carers' assistance, the new benefit, which will replace carers' allowance, but we know that that is going to take some considerable time before it addresses the rate and eligibility for carers' assistance. That means that unpaid carers in Scotland are having to wait for promised reforms and have more money in their pocket for too long. We have a chance just now, today, to keep the uplift on a permanent basis until the carers' assistant is introduced. And carers agree that Carers Scotland have estimated that every day of the COVID-19 pandemic, unpaid carers saved the Scottish Government £43 million. And a contributor to that report said the supplement must be doubled permanently. If the government had to pay for outside agencies to do the work of unpaid carers, it would cost a lot more. Carers are completely undervalued and forgotten about. And that was from an unpaid carer themselves. I fundamentally believe that we have an opportunity right now, while the teeth of the pandemic are still biting, to make sure that we retain the uplift. The correct thing to do was to double the supplement in this year, and the correct thing to do is give carers certainty going into the future and until we've reviewed carers' assistance in Scotland. I urge the committee to vote for this amendment to make sure that we do that not just once a year, as amendment number one suggests, because I believe carers are not just for Christmas. Unpaid carers are for much more, and actually I believe we need to do that twice a year and make the payment twice. So I urge the committee, please support carers, thank them for the work that they've done and value them, give them extra money in their pocket and support the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much, Ms. Pam Duncan-Glancy. I now call Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. I think this bill absolutely shows that Scottish Government value carers, and we do. And we heard in the evidence in earlier sessions that carers do really, really appreciate what the government is trying to do. Obviously, the Scottish Government wants to do more, but we have to make these changes in a planned fashion, and there is an enabling power in the bill to increase carers' allowance supplement, but it has to be done in a proper planned fashion.
Do you remember taking intervention on that?
Yeah.
I absolutely agree it needs to be planned, and that's why in December we'll have a budget, and we'll have a planned budget which will then be decided. And what both these amendments do is give certainty in regard to any plan. So this is not new money that's having to be found in a set budget. This is a new budget. What more planning needs to take place when we're having a budget negotiations over the next few months?
I think that's up to the Scottish Government to look at in the round. And I don't...
I take the point about planning, but I believe that there is considerable, or I hope that there is considerable planning undergoing anyway as a result of looking at carers' assistance in the future. But I'd also ask the member to consider the planning that unpaid carers have to do to plan for their financial circumstances and their household bills. And it is far easier to plan when we know certainties rather than uncertainties left at the discretion of the possibility of ministers deciding at any point that it is not going to double, that they are not going to double the uplift.
I take the member's point there, but I would say the Scottish Government is listening. I think we heard that from the evidence. And I would also acknowledge that the Scottish Government has introduced 7 brand new benefits already and 4 replacement benefits, and they are more generous than elsewhere in the UK. So I think the Scottish Government is listening. Yep.
Thank you for taking the intervention. And you're right to point out that in some ways it has been more generous, but carers, unpaid carers in their homes are not comparing themselves to someone else elsewhere in the UK. They're comparing themselves to other people who are not providing unpaid care, who are considerably better off because they're not having to provide unpaid care, or their unpaid carers not getting any access to carers' allowance because it's not been, eligibility hasn't been extended. So they're getting nothing comparing themselves to people who are. So actually, those are the comparisons that unpaid carers out in our constituencies and communities that we represent are making, not whether or not someone's better off elsewhere.
Again, I acknowledge your point, but I would still go back to say that the Scottish Government are listening, and going forward, they will be looking at the situation for carers. And I would also like to say again that in evidence, carers acknowledged what the Scottish Government was trying to do and welcomed what the Scottish Government was trying to do.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Tweed. Marie McNair, please.
Thank you, Convener. I welcome the key aims of this bill, which are summarised. 1, recognise the massive contribution that unpaid carers have made during this pandemic by doubling the amount of the carers' assistance supplement. Getting the money into the pockets of carers at Christmas, a real time of financial pressure for families. And also, it's a part of the Scottish Government's continuous approach to rectifying the long-term injustice of carers I've had from the Westminster Parliament. In addition, it's to the £149 million we have rightly provided to 120,000 carers since September 2018. But I don't support the ad hoc approach to the amendment it's taken to setting the future rates of the supplement. The proper way to do that is through the budget process, as this guarantees. Yep.
Interventions, if we could make sure that they're brief, please.
Thank you, Convener. Noted. Could you describe why you think this is ad hoc?
I think we need to plan. I think it's important we get it right. I think at the end of the day, 45 years of parties, I'm going to carry on. So it's really important that we have meaningful consultation with carers about how we best support them through the new carers assistance benefit. And I think, Mr Balfour, you should bring forward a proposal as part of your Tory budget and show then how to balance the books. It's also said that the supplement should go further if the carers, UK Tories, finally get the right things and aligned the value of the carers' allowance with job seekers' allowance. 45 years you've had. Obviously, again, in response to your point, Pam, I don't support the ad hoc nature of the amendment. The best way to do it is make this spending commitment £40 million. The bill already has enabling powers that my colleague has already mentioned. It allows the ability to increase the level of supplement as part of the budget process. And from my contributions in the Chamber and the Committee, Pam, you'll know, like you, I recognise there's much more we need to do to provide a decent system of social security. There's a lot we still need to do to mitigate the impact of the Westminster cuts. And given the scale of what we want to do, it must be done through the budget process. And we must do it alongside carers as we develop the new system. It's really important that we consult. In addition to the increase of doubling the amount to assist with the impact of the COVID-19 supplement, we've fixed a wrong inflicted by the carers for years. As again, mentioned it last week, since 1976, was initially introduced invalid carers allowance, and the obviously successive UK government's refused to align the amount. So now carers have a 13% increase, with the addition it will be £690 better off than the carers down south. And I say, again, 45 years collectively, Pam. And,
will the member take an intervention?
No. And you've made no effort to address the concerns of carers elsewhere either. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Ms McNair. I could remind colleagues to please debate through the chair, and also when referring to colleagues, if you could do so using their full names for the benefit of those watching, please. Call Emma Roddick, please.
Thank you. I think we can all agree here that this extra winter payment is needed this year and deserved, particularly in light of the work that carers do and the extra burdens that have been created for them over the pandemic. I'm not sure that taking a decision right now to uplift by the same amount next year, given we've all learned in the last 2 years that we cannot at the moment now know what next winter is going to look like, is really the right thing to do. I am reassured that the bill does give ministers the power to make further increases as part of the budget process, as has been done, certainly.
Your colleague talked about ad hoc. Oh, sorry, Commissioner. Thank you, Commissioner. We've had a conversation here about ad hoc is not the way forward. That means carers cannot plan. We do not agree that for carers to have certainty rather than ad hoc decisions made at a whim of a minister is a much better way forward. And all benefits have to be paid and administered. So in every budget discussion, we have to work out a Social Security budget which has to be paid.
I am here today hopeful that we are going to give carers certainty that this winter they're going to get an extra payment which is needed. And I think we have to recognise that Scotland will now be the only country in the UK where carers allowance is no longer the lowest of working age benefits, thanks to this supplement. And Mr Balfour is right when he said earlier that these are political decisions. He could always encourage his colleagues in the UK government to increase carers allowance itself to the level of job seekers and let this supplement go further. I think the context is important here because what we are discussing is an increase to a top-up, to a benefit which is the lowest paid of any UK working age benefit. It is a short-term intervention to get extra cash into carers' pockets this Christmas because their UK carers allowance payments are woefully inadequate. We have heard from witnesses in the last few months who told us, amongst other things, that there are huge issues around eligibility for carers' allowance. And we've already heard that this is going to benefit an estimated 1 in 10 carers, which is nowhere near good enough. So I think we do have to consider the need for the government to have appropriate time to consult with carers, those they care for, carers' organisations, in order to bring in a carers' assistance which will reach as many people as possible, rather than clumsily introducing an amendment to increase a top-up to a payment that we know is inadequate. There's not endless money, so I think it is right at the moment that we accept this extra payment as a positive thing that is aiming to top up a flawed system. And nobody in this room disagrees that carers deserve more, but we have to do it right.
Thank you, Ms Roddick. I'd now call the Minister, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, colleagues. Convener, first of all, I just want to emphasise that this government absolutely values the role of unpaid carers. We are the government which introduced the carers allowance supplement in 2018 to ensure carers no longer receive the lowest benefit, as Emma Roddick rightly highlighted. And we introduced the Young Carer Grant. Both of these benefits are unique in the UK, and are two of seven brand new benefits we have introduced to provide more financial support for the people of our country, as Evelyn Tweed rightly emphasised. Through our social security powers, we now invest more than £350 million a year in supporting carers through carers allowance supplement and the Young Carer Grant, so a significant investment. And since 2018, around 574,000 carers allowance supplement payments have been made totalling £149.4 million and made to around 120,000 carers. Carers continuously in receipt of carers allowance and carers allowance supplement will have received over, as I said earlier, £2,270 more than carers in the rest of the UK. So I, like colleagues around the table, would of course like to see carers receive more support. That is where we're working towards together. And I would encourage, as part of this, as Emma Roddick rightly emphasised and Marie McNair also said, the UK government to increase the rate of carers allowance, which would see over 900,000 carers across Great Britain receive increased support and would mean our supplement would go further. So we recognise and this is a really important point, as Pam Duncan-Glancy emphasised, that the pandemic has identified a need for greater flexibility in how we support carers when society faces significant changing circumstances. And that is why last year we used the emergency coronavirus legislation to introduce an additional payment, and to do so last year. And that is why we are doing so again this year. And of course, that's what this bill is all about. And to prevent the need for primary legislation to be needed in the future, the bill includes a power to enable ministers to bring forward regulations which could increase the amount of the carers allowance supplement in the future. And that's an important enabling power that we proactively put into this bill. In terms of this financial year, as I've already said this morning, we have secured the resource for a doubling of the December carers allowance supplement, which is why we prioritise bringing this bill forward. And again, thank you to the committee for their work in the expedited process of this. This is the first of the first bill of this term to get to stage two. And we're doing it with that pace to focus on ensuring we get this resource to carers in December. Now, I appreciate the ambition and desire of members to try to provide more assistance. And Mr. Balfour, both today and on Tuesday, talked about political choices. And we do have political choices to make, just as we have financial ones. And we are choosing, as a government, to make a difference where we can. We chose to mitigate the low value of the carers allowance through this supplement to the cost of around £40 million a year since 2018. And we've done that because we want to make a difference. We chose to mitigate the bedroom tax at a cost of £70 million a year. We chose to introduce the Scottish Child Payment and bridging payments to support thousands of children and put £130 million into the pockets of families in this financial year. These are the political and financial choices this government makes every year within its fixed budget. And that is an important point. We have a fixed budget. And we chose to pay last year and this an additional carers allowance supplement of more than £230, as I've said. A choice we may be able to make in the future, depending on the budget and what else, this is an important point, and what else we do with Scottish Carers Assistance as it develops into a new replacement benefit for carers. Because we have choices ahead, through the development of Scottish Carers Assistance, we are looking at options for the longer term, which will increase our support for carers through our social security system. And as the committee will know, we begin our consultation this winter on proposals for the delivery of Scottish Carers Assistance. This will require us to carefully consider the balance to be struck between extending eligibility for Scottish Carers Assistance and increasing the amount of Scottish Carers Assistance. And so, as I said in the Stage 1 debate, future increases to the Carers Allowance Supplement will be considered in the context of the circumstances faced by carers and the financial constraints we face. If we were to commit the resource that the amendments before us today ask us to, and to commit this resource over future years,
we potentially couldn't utilise it to support carers in other ways, which is why we need to consider these issues in the round and why I cannot support either of these amendments and urge committee members to reject them. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. To wind up the debate, I call Jeremy Balfour to press or withdraw Amendment 1. Jeremy Balfour, if you could be brief with your wind-up, please.
Thank you, Convener. Just a few points to respond to the debate that we've had. I mean, I was very proud back in May to be elected to the Scottish Parliament and to have powers that we've got within this Parliament. And I think that's what I'm here to do. I'm here to use the powers that this Scottish Parliament has. And I have to say, I disagree with Evelyn Tweed that this is a Scottish Government decision. I think this is a decision that we make as a Parliament, and that's why we've been elected, to be the voice of those who are perhaps the most vulnerable in our society. And I don't believe in a dictatorship. I believe in democracy, and I believe in parties playing their role in regard to that. And I think that's a really important point. I think the other point that the Minister made there is it's not a fixed budget that we have. You have powers, if you want to increase or decrease the budget. So this is not a fixed budget that you are set. It's a budget that is variable depending on decisions made by this government and made by the Parliament. I think the number of the issue is that we all want to see Scottish Carers Assistance come in. But as the Minister has pointed out, we're starting the process in December with a consultation, which will then, rightly so, take people's views. The government will then rightly respond to that consultation, and then we'll have the proposals coming after that. That is not going to happen overnight. It's not going to happen next year. It's not probably going to happen in the year after. I think the provisional date is 2025. That leaves us with 4 years of uncertainty of whether Ben McPherson and the Cabinet Secretary have successful negotiations with the director, with the Cabinet Secretary of Finance. Marie McNair said, we don't want an ad hoc system. I absolutely agree. I don't want an ad hoc system. I want absolute certainty. And I want the Scottish Government to know that when they're planning their budget, that this payment will either be made doubled once or twice a year, depending on which amendment we go for. We all have choices to make. I am not an MP, and I'm not there to make choices at Westminster. I am here, and we're all here in this committee today, to make choices that we can influence here in Scotland. And that's why I will be pressing my amendment.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Balfour. The question is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The colleagues are not agreed, so there will be a division. All those in favour, please raise your hand. All those against, please raise your hand. Thank you. On Amendment 1, the votes were 4 against, 4 for. Therefore, there is a tie. I'll be using my casting vote, and given what the Minister and what colleagues have said, I'll be casting my vote against the amendment today. So the amendment is not agreed. We now move on to call Amendment 6 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy, already debated with Amendment 1. Pam Duncan-Glancy to move or not move.
Thank you, Convener. I move the amendment.
Thank you very much. The question is that Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? No, we are not agreed. Therefore, there will be a division. All those in favour, please raise your hand. Thank you. All those against. Thank you very much. On the vote on Amendment 6, there were 4 against, 4 for. Therefore, there is a tie. I'll be using my casting vote again based on what the Minister and what colleagues have said in the committee today. I'll be using that casting vote opposed to that amendment. Therefore, the amendment is not agreed to. I will now move to call Amendment 8 in the name of Maggie Chapman, already debated with Amendment 4. Maggie Chapman to move or not move?
Not moved.
However, since Maggie Chapman has chosen not to move, there has since been a debate, and I wonder whether other colleagues would wish to move. No. The Amendment 8 is not moved. Are we all agreed to... move on. I'll therefore call Amendment 9 in the name of Maggie Chapman, already debating with Amendment 4. Maggie Chapman, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you very much indeed. That amendment is not moved. And to give colleagues a couple of minutes as a comfort break, I'll now suspend for 2 minutes. Thank you very much and welcome back. I now call Amendment 2 in the name of Jeremy Balfour in a group on its own. Jeremy Balfour to move and speak to Amendment 2, please.
Thank you, Convener. Having had a obviously really important debate previously, this is a bit nerdy and will be for more for technical amendment. However, I do think it's an important one for at least to debate and for us to come to a view on. And that is in regard to how we as a committee and how the Parliament should look at any regulations that the government bring forward in due course in regard to this bill. We heard in the previous debate that from a number of members and the Minister that there is power here for the government to bring forward regulations in regard to whether they have that amount varied and how that will vary. Regulations often end up as a committee at a very late stage and often don't get the proper scrutiny that is required. And that is no criticism of anyone. I think it's just the way the system works. But I think if we have the super affirmative, it at least gives us a time to pause and look at these regulations in a proper way. It also allows a third party, a third group, to be able to have a valuable tool to look at it as well, to make sure that there's no unforeseen circumstances behind them, and also it allows us a bit longer just to consider the regulations. I think it gives a proper check, and it is one thing that when we were putting through the original bill and now Act in the previous session, we were very keen that because many of these benefits affect very vulnerable people, that we want to all get it right, including government and the Parliament. So for that reason, I do think having the super affirmative in regard to these regulations will allow us a bit more scrutiny. It will, I suppose, in some ways, make the government think about it a bit quicker because they will have to be produced in a quicker way, but they will go through proper scrutiny. And I would be interested to hear what the Minister has to say in regard to that. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Balfour, not least for your brevity. I cannot see any other colleagues wishing to come in at this stage. Marie McNair.
Thank you. In regards to this amendment, I minded to think it's unnecessary at this stage. If you think about the evidence that we heard early on, the submissions that carers wanted this paid as quick as possible, so I think it would maybe create a delay. It's not helpful. And obviously, you recall, again, from the evidence from the Scottish Commission on Social Security, there seemed to be possibly capacity issues there, so delays associated with going down this road, so I'm not supportive of this way forward.
Many thanks, Ms McNair. Are there any other colleagues? No. Call the Minister to speak to this amendment.
Thanks, Convener, and I appreciate Mr Balfour's points in bringing this forward. However, I do not believe that this amendment is required. First of all, I want to emphasise that the Scottish Commission on Social Security plays a really important role in providing a detailed level of scrutiny to draft Social Security regulations where the advice of experts in Social Security is required. However, any decision to increase the amount of an existing benefit must be made in the context of the wider financial and non-financial support provided to those entitled to the benefit and within the wider fiscal context and the limits of our budget. These are decisions best suited to this Parliament. So given the changes that can be made under any regulations brought forward under the new power that we're seeking to introduce as part of this legislation are limited to increasing the level of the supplement for a specific period or periods, we therefore do not consider that the further scrutiny by the Scottish Commission on Social Security is necessary or appropriate in this instance. The application of the affirmative procedure here will allow members adequate opportunity to consider any regulations in draft. I would also note that this position was supported in the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee's Stage 1 report on the bill. And therefore, Convener, considering all of those points, I do not support this amendment and would urge Mr Balfour not to press Amendment 2, or if he does and it is moved, that it is not supported by the committee. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. I appreciate your brevity. I now call Jeremy Balfour to wind up to press or withdraw Amendment 2, please.
Thank you, Convener. Can I thank the Minister for his reflective comments on this? I mean, I do agree with, again, Marie McNair that I think, Scots, there are issues around the capacity for Scots, and I think that's something we as a Parliament need to look at going forward. The regulations that I'm talking about are future regulations, and I don't think, unless the Minister misunderstands why, what I'm looking to do is regulations going forward, not affecting the December payment. However, I think the Minister has made some interesting points, and with your permission, Convener, I would like to reflect on those and not move the amendment now and see where we are at stage three.
Thank you very much indeed. Mr Balfour is seeking to withdraw the amendment. Are all colleagues content? Thank you very much indeed. We now move to the question being that section 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question next is that section 3 and 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
And that the question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much indeed, colleagues. That ends our consideration of stage 2. I wish to make it known to colleagues that the deadline for stage 3 amendments is 12 noon on Monday, the 4th of October, and we expect the Parliament to consider stage 3 on Thursday, the 5th of October. I'd like to thank the Minister and non-committee members and Minister's officials for joining us this morning. I'll briefly suspend the meeting before moving on to our next agenda item. Thank you, colleagues. Thank you very much indeed, colleagues. At agenda item 5, the committee is invited to consider two negative SSIs. Again, it might be helpful if I clarify some procedural points for colleagues. SSIs laid under the negative procedure will come into force automatically unless the Parliament passes a motion to annul or they are withdrawn by the Scottish Government. There is no procedure for amending the SSI. It is not possible for us to accept some parts of the SSI but not others. The only way for a committee member to stop a negative SSI coming into force would be to seek to lodge a motion to annul the instrument. That being said, the committee can make recommendations for future changes to be brought forward through other changes or highlight any concerns it may have to the Scottish Government. We will now move to the first negative instrument under consideration, the Social Security Claims and Payments Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland Regulations 2021. These regulations would allow large payments of arrears of devolved disability benefits to be paid in instalments to Scottish clients if the consent is given by the client. Further background information is outlined in paper 4 in our briefing papers. Do members have any comments they would like to raise in regard to these regulations at this stage? Nope. Are members content to note this instrument? Thank you very much indeed, colleagues. We move to consideration of the second negative instrument under this agenda item. I invite members to refer to paper 5, which details our consideration of the Council Tax Reduction Scotland Regulations 2021. The purpose of these regulations is to ensure that, as far as practicable, a household in the same circumstances receives the same level of council tax reduction, whether it is on universal credit or not. The committee wrote to stakeholders in advance of today's meeting to invite further views on these regulations, and I wish to thank, on behalf of the committee, Citizens Advice Scotland, CPAG, One Parent Family Scotland and IRRV for their responses. I also thank the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth for his written response to the issues raised. Do members at this stage have any comments they would wish to raise in relation to this regulation? Yes, I'll call Pam Duncan-Glancy first.
Thank you, Convener. First of all, to say I will support the regulations. Just a couple of questions I have around it, I guess. It's really complex. I don't know if it's just me, but it felt like it was very, very complex. And there wasn't that much time to really get underneath the skin of it, to be honest. And I wondered if we're content that we're happy enough that there's been enough data provided on this and that we understand who really who the winners and losers are. I, of course, welcome the application and the levelling of the people on legacy benefits and universal credit. I think it is absolutely the right thing to do. I would just say, do we really understand specifically the differences and who's going to do okay and who's not out of it? That would be the only concern I would have.
Thank you, Ms. Duncan-Glancy. I'm happy to make a suggestion on that part if any colleagues would wish to raise any further concerns. My suggestion would be to write again to the Minister to seek further detail on that part, if that would be helpful to colleagues in the committee and to would answer the points raised by Pam Duncan-Glancy. Okay. In which case, first of all, would colleagues be happy for that to go ahead, to write to the Minister again, just to seek further comment, and I'd invite Ms Duncan-Glancy to work with the clerks in order to frame the questions that you would seek to have answers to. And I would ask our members otherwise content to note the instrument.
The start-up costs of the new system, the lost income to councils, will be quite a lot. It's important that councils are fully compensated for this. And also notice there's no guidance for the councils on how the scheme is administered. Can we have a wee bit of background on that as well?
If Ms Duncan-Glancy is content for Marie McNair to work along those lines in that same letter to the Minister.
Absolutely. Thanks.
Thank you. In which case, are we content to note the instrument? Thank you very much indeed, colleagues. That concludes the public part of this morning's meeting. I suspend to move into private session. Thank you.